Welcome back, adventurers, for another video. This one's actually going to be a little bit different than what we're used to because this is the first vlog that I'm doing. Now, I hope to continue these types of videos in order to educate the community and for me to get educated by the community as well. I know there's a lot of controversy behind these types of topics, and I feel like it's good that we discuss them in a formal manner. So let's get ahead and dive right into the video. I want to start by clarifying that I'm not against dry dog food. As a matter of fact, I feed my dogs dry dog food. I completely understand that sometimes your lifestyle and what you're doing don't completely allow you to feed your dogs raw 24/7. Whether you don't have space in your fridge for raw 28 meals, in my case 28 because I own two dogs, whether you don't have the money to feed them full raw because it is cheaper to feed dry than raw, whether it's time constraint, maybe you don't have 2 to 3 hours a week to prep all the meals. And unfortunately, there is no fast food for dogs like we have. I mean, if we don't cook, we just go out and we buy something. You can't really do that for dogs. So if I'm not against dog food, then what exactly am I advocating? Well, it's pretty simple. I'm against a large corporation. Now, I'm not gonna bash all these food brands that fall under each corporation, but I'm gonna bash the way that they handle their services and how they got to where they are. From what it looks like is that these companies are only in it for the profit. Now, I understand if you're skeptical, let's look at the numbers then. In 2018, Mars profited $17 billion. Nestle profited $12 billion. Hillscience, $2.2 billion. And Blue Buffalo, $1 billion. And the list goes on. So why does this even matter? Who cares how much money they made, right? The problem is that money is a huge factor in the world we live in today. The more money a company has, the more they can invest into veterinarian schools, into research, into nutritional classes, events, donations, and so on. Now this is wonderful, the only problem is that it starts creating bias in the community. If people are predisposed to a positive side of a company, they're more likely to purchase it. Not only that, but because you see it around you so often, you're more likely to just settle with what you're seeing. And this actually causes people to be defensive when people start targeting that specific brand that they're so used to. So let's go with an example that we're all very familiar with, right? We all take our dogs to the vet. Now, when you walk into the vet, you look to the right, there's the counter, or you maybe the left, whatever. What is the one brand that you often see on the shelves? It's either Royal Canine or it's Hillscience. And what kind of bothers me is that there's no options. You're literally limiting me to one brand and then specific different dietary options within that brand. So what I'm seeing is that you're marketing to me, the customer, one brand, and that one brand is supposed to have all my dog needs to be healthy. So let's talk about the number one ingredient that everybody knows. And right now you're probably thinking what I'm about to say. Well, if you thought corn, you're absolutely right. But before I start talking bad about it, let me talk about something that's good about corn. Because this is not something that you often see in videos like this. There's two advantages that I'll give corn. One, it allows for people who are going through rough times to continue buying food for their dog. Corn is a cheap alternative to some sources of food. And I'm not completely against corn. That's not the problem. The problem is how much they use corn. But for this sake, corn does provide an alternative option. However, I will say that if you continue buying dogs or continue adopting dogs, and you're kind of buying these $5 40-pound bags, you're only hurting the dog. But then I'm conflicted too because I don't know if I would rather have a dog be fed $5 40-pound bag of dog food or for a dog to be in the shelter by himself in a not loving family. So this is more like morally based, and I'll just leave that up to you. It can be however you want. The other advantage to corn is that it is nutritionally beneficial for dogs in some way, okay? And the reason that I'm saying these types of stuff, because I know some people are already shaking their head like, no, corn is bad. Like, guys, this is what I'm trying to break. I'm trying to break the stigma that we need to fight against each other. Let's talk about the basics. And corn is, to a point, nutritionally beneficial for a dog. I understand that it's not the same as meat. And I'm saying that if this is the baseline for how nutritional something is, corn is like right here and literally everything else is above it. But that goes back to the reason number one is that because it does offer that nutritional standard, it allows for it to be a cheap alternative and for people to be able to purchase the dog food if they can't afford more expensive types of dog food. Now, the problem isn't that corn is beneficial. The problem is how bad it's stretched. Food companies will glorify corn, making it seem like it's the holy grail of ingredients and that dogs are benefiting crazy from it, that it's good for joints, coats, teeth, freaking everything in between. And that's what irks me. It's not the fact that corn is bad. It's the fact that they abuse corn and they know they're abusing it because that's how they're making such high profit. And honestly, all you have to do is start researching. If corn is so healthy, why does that same brand take off corn when you look at their more expensive line? This product, what are you going to see? Corn, animal byproduct, corn, wheat, rice. But if you look at their most expensive line, what are you going to see? Meats, grain-free peas, whatever it may be. Or it can be meat, rice, meats, vegetables here and there, whole ground corn or something like that. What I'm getting at is that the more expensive the dog food is, the less corn you're going to see. And companies even make different names for the corn. Sometimes you have whole grain corn, corn gluten meal, ground whole corn. And guess where those ingredients are? Right at the top of the list. Why would you put corn before chicken? Are you really telling me that corn is more beneficial than chicken? And if it's not, then why are you putting chicken flavor on the front of the bag and not corn flavor? Because that's what it is. Now, just to continue the train, let's say you're interested in feeding your dog raw. You go to YouTube, you take out your keyboard and you start typing blah, 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 how to feed a dog raw food. Click. First video, I'll watch the first one, right? It has a lot of views. You click it. What would you think if the guy's like, if he takes out a giant can of corn and he's like, all right, guys, like, hey, corn is the spinach to your dog. They're Popeye. Your dog is Popeye. He likes spinach. This is spinach. You know, boom, it makes sense. Corn. Just feed your dog a lot of corn. Corn is going to be 70% of what you're going to feed him. Just put a tub of corn and then like, just sausage links. And a piece of ham, and he's like, all right, we're good, bro. Here, boom. Oh, and a bunch of vitamins, you know, just add the vitamins. No? What is the first thing you would think if you saw somebody add so much corn to a raw food diet? Or corn at all? You would immediately dislike, unsubscribe, report for, I don't know, animal abuse, something, and go somewhere else, right? Now, let's say your dog has diarrhea. He has stomach issues. Something's wrong with your dog, right? You take him to the vet. The vet sees him. He's like, yep, he has something in his stomach. Here, feed him this. It's a can of corn. Most of the time, your vet is going to offer you what? Pedialyte? Maybe fast him for a day? And then what? Chicken broth with ripped pieces of chicken. Not corn broth or corn pie or corn whatever, but chicken. And I always find this interesting is that they offer chicken in these scenarios, but then most vets are against raw food. So it's kind of like, well, why would I feed my dog chicken broth if raw food is so bad? And if chicken broth is so good, then why aren't you trying to sell that in your product line? But enough about corn. We all get it. We already kind of knew that corn was bad. I'm just giving you guys more tools for your collection. So let's move into something else that food companies are using to entice people to purchase their product for their own benefit. The use of flavor in bags is something that I also really despise. This is simply an advertising tactic used to encourage people to buy their product. So what's the motive behind it? The well-being of the dog or making money? I mean, if you look up what flavor is in the website, it's basically saying it's meant to make it taste like that. Whatever flavor it is, whether it's chicken, beef, whatever. So you're telling me that you're trying to confuse my dog into thinking he's eating chicken when in reality he's eating what? I just put it in the ingredients list, whatever the flavor is. And this kind of irks me because it's more for the people than it is for the dog. My dog doesn't care what it is, if he's gonna like it or unlike it regardless. I've bought some expensive dog food that they don't like and it literally smells like fish. These flashy lights are just for who? For us. It's for us to fall into the traps of purchasing that. And I would rather have a company be transparent with what they're selling me, try to fool people or trick them into buying something that's not exactly there. And the problem is that a lot of people might not know the use of flavor in dog food. Something close to flavor but a little bit different is the dye. The blue, the red, the yellow, all these dyes that they put in the dog food. You really think your dog's gonna go to the bowl and be like, yeah, I like the blue ones more. I'm gonna eat only the blue ones. No, your dog doesn't know the difference between blue, red, white, orange, whatever. Colored dye is specifically made for us, not for the dogs. It's made for humans to think that they're buying something that looks tasty. And this goes back to what I said earlier with the product line, right? You get the cheap one, you put all these crazy flavors, these dyes, irrelevant stuff. You go to their top line, what is something that you don't see? flavor and dye. It's almost like the cheaper ones are more enticing to customers than the more expensive ones. Also, why are you putting vegetables in the front of the bag if you're not even going to put them in the ingredients list? So what are we, as pet owners, left with in the end? Well, unfortunately, we are left with a divided community. On one side, we have people who advocate for raw and only feed raw and hate people who feed dry. On the other side, we have people who only feed dry and would never consider feeding raw for whatever reason. But the truth is that we all just want what's best for our dog. So next time somebody challenges your ideas, like I am now, don't attack them and don't take it as an insult. Instead, listen to what they're saying. Learn from what they're saying if there's anything to learn about. And if there isn't, then maybe you've done more research than they have in that topic and maybe you can educate them. Or let's be honest, sometimes we're very biased as to what our beliefs are. And maybe they said something that had you thinking, you went home and you Googled it, and hey, turned out that they weren't exactly wrong. And this helps you provide a healthier lifestyle for your dogs, for your animals, and even for yourself. So I actually challenge everybody watching this video to research the brand that you have right now in your house. Don't do it to prove someone wrong or to prove someone right. Do it for your own pet's health. There's a quote that I read somewhere online that said that there's a difference between thriving and surviving. And I think that quote really embodies what we're trying to do. And maybe some of the rationalizations that some people create, saying that their dog has been fine and that their parents fed their dog for 30 years, Purina, whatever brand. And guys, there's a difference between, again, thriving and surviving. There's humans who smoke cigarettes once a day and die at like 110 years old. I mean, it just so happens to be like that sometimes. But with that being said, if you guys noticed that I said something that was misleading or incorrect, please put that down in the comment section below and I will kindly thank you for educating me further in the topic. I personally don't mind admitting that I'm wrong, and I actually find it better to have these types of conversations with people because you both end up learning from each other. Thank you guys so much for watching, and if you enjoyed the video, please give us a thumbs up, a comment, and a subscribe. We would really appreciate it. I'll be doing more vlogs like this throughout the future, so keep an eye out for them. And nothing but peace and love from my pack to yours. Thank you guys for watching.